just in terms of the segments in agri, I think inputs is a large segment where you know, you're providing farmers inputs for their crops, and also agronomy support and advice and so on. So that's one category of startups, and AgroStar falls in that. They provide, if they're an e-commerce provider for agri inputs for farmers. Then you have companies that actually help in improving the yield within the farm. This could be companies with drones technologies, IoT technologies, what they call as precision agri technologies, and farm management solutions, farming as a service. I don't know if you've heard of that. So all these kinds of solutions are aimed at helping the farmers double their yield or just get more out of their current cropping patterns that they have. Then the third category is financial support, which is where Samanathi is. So this could be individually to farmers or to farmer FPOs that you've heard of. So which are collectives of farmers, so supporting them financially. So that is a third sector. The fourth sector, and which is where a lot of the investments are going, are on the output side, either on providing linkages to farmers to be able to sell and get better prices on their products, on the produce, or full stack organizations who are doing farm to fork. So I think these are the large categories. And then you have the fifth category, which is allied categories like dairy and shrimp and fisheries and some of those. And there, again, you have platforms that are helping, standardize and aggregate and provide certain support for these fisheries and these dairy kind of allied sectors. So this would be kind of the broad spectrum of opportunities in agri. Yeah, so what the government really wants to do is give more power to the farmer to choose to whom and when and how he or she wants to sell his produce. And they don't want them to be kind of constrained to sell to only intermediaries where, they don't have the right visibility on pricing, or they don't have the right, leverage with them. So they want the farmers to get more leverage. And so this disintermediation is what technology can play a great role in, right? So platforms, this is where the Ninja Cart kind of platforms, we have another company called Clover, which not only provides this linkage, but also helps farmers manage their farms from seed to produce, and also helps them sell the produce. The new reforms enable these to function without any friction, because one thing you have to understand is agriculture is a state subject. So every state had its own rules and had its own legislation. Some states were more forward-looking, which allowed the farmers to directly sell to anybody. Nevertheless, most of the country now will benefit from this relaxation and the enablement of this is mostly through startups, because startups are the ones that are bridging this gap between the farmer and the consumer. See, Bangalore has this very nice characteristic of being an early adopter.
Right.
The very early, whether it's the cult gyms that started or whether it's the Swiggy ordering that started, everything kind of, I think Bangalore's customers kind of are closer to or behave more like folks from any other global hotspot than any other Indian city. So I think this... it's easier to test your early adoption hypothesis. And I think that's one of the reasons why even in the agri startups, some of these Ninja Carts, and they actually started here in Karnataka and in Bangalore. When 3 years ago or 4 years ago is when we started looking at the agri sector. So you had these very passionate few people who would really come in and try to, it was because like you said, there were not that many investors. It was not very clear if from a regulatory perspective, they would get the right support. So the very few and the brave ventured into this space. But now we see a broader set of investors and some of them actually coming from, you know, Thiru, who's the founder of Ninja Card, actually came from Taxi for Sure. So you're starting to see people with other varied and more deep entrepreneurial experience now coming into the agri sector. And when that happens, I think funds naturally follow, because I think there is a big belief that these entrepreneurs are seeing the opportunity and they can execute. And one important point I'd like to make is, while there is a lot of talk of agri-tech, I think agri is a very execution-heavy sector. Technology has a role to play. Operationally, it will help you scale. But I think entrepreneurs who are good in execution will benefit. And so you'll see entrepreneurs who have been in other execution-heavy spaces move into agri because they believe that they can succeed here. You're right, a few of them may be, like if you're in the warehousing business, if you're in the cold chain business, some of these were traditional capex heavy sectors. But if you look at some of the new generation agri startups, they're trying to, because that's what attracts venture capital, asset light businesses, they're slightly moving into the asset light businesses. Post-pandemic, the focus is on profitability. So with that being the case, I think some of these newer agri startups are going to focus on, you know, being more prudent and trying to get to, Samanathi is a very good example. They're already very positive. And a company like Samanathi, you know, there's a good track record of financial companies going public. So that would be a very natural path for them. But some few of the others may build profitably, but could have, you know, M&A exits. But to kind of specifically answer your question, I think it will be both M&As and IPOs in this sector. And these are sectors that are well understood by public sector investors. I think there are a lot of agri companies that have gone public before. Where agri consumer, I think agri consumer, I don't see a big difference in how agri consumers will, consumer businesses will get valued to, let's say, a FMCG, direct to consumer, D2C brand business will get valued. And I think there is a belief that the digital transformation in the agri sector relative to other sectors is going to be exponential. So the ability, so valuations usually are a function of two things, right? The potential outcome, the how big is the final outcome, and how fast can you get there, right? So I think on both these, I think investors are positive that the opportunities are large in the sector. I mean, maybe comparable only to sectors like EdTech. And so, I mean, in terms of emerging sectors. So in terms of emerging sectors, I would put EdTech, AgriTech as... and the good thing about AgriTech is it has great B2B and B2C opportunities. So that's... I mean, if you see some of the businesses that are starting to come up in agri, I'm not talking about specifically Axel investments, but there are interesting B2B supply chain investments also that are coming up. So of course, then there would be a difference. B2B companies get very differently valued from B2C companies, and that would be true for agri also. Two things, I think... It's the 100 million farmer base in the country, right? And the belief that today maybe 30-40% of them are smartphone enabled, but you know, 50-80 million of them should be smartphone enabled in the next few years, like maybe just even the next 2 years. And if you look at also a homogeneous, not homogeneous, a specific industry sector that is percent of the GDP, and that is targeted and addressed by maybe this 50-70 million people, this intersection is pretty interesting, right? So, and the third reason is, I think, change in consumer habits. I think there is a belief that consumers want better and better products, more fresh stuff. There is a better awareness and maybe a willingness to pay for good high value products now than before. We do very little value add when it comes to our agri produce, but I think you will which means that a lot of it is not really capitalized from a potential perspective. So the two challenges: one is better yields through better agronomy support and better technology support, I think is already happening. And I think there's enough investments going in there. But I think the new areas that people are trying to look at and see, and I don't think still there is a model, I think the right entrepreneurial model, and because, you know, doing so a lot of these value add sectors tend to get into manufacturing and maybe a lot of CapEx and others. But I think there is a opportunity there, just like you have the personal, like in the FMCG, you have seen a big VC interest in personal care products and direct to consumer personal care products. Will there be a new generation of closer to farm, consumer products being built by entrepreneurs that will have a demand in metros and other tier 2, tier 3 cities, is something that I think also is interesting investors, but I don't know if they really already have the right companies there. India B2B continues to be an area of interest. So we have many companies there like Moglix, Inframarket, Bizongo, and so on. So that's an interesting category for us. There are, we believe, still many sectors where the supply chain, demand chain, and you know, the whole efficiency that these extended enterprise that is required for these enterprises to achieve in the extended enterprise digital world. I think there is still room in some of those, and we are looking at new companies there. EdTech, I don't think everything is done there. There could be, of course, Vedantu has benefited a lot, is scaling rapidly, but I'm sure there are new EdTech opportunities that may emerge. I think some of these are some of the, and of course, the whole future of work that we spoke of.